And I'm going to speak to you today on why the change in the weather. What's happened in these changing days to our weather? What's happening in the heavens? What has happened that brought all of confusion and perplexity, not only up in the heavens, but upon earth? Let us pray. Father, we do thank you today for every blessing of being here. We thank you, Lord, for this blessed service, for the Holy Spirit. And our Father, I pray now, as we come to bring this message, that every person shall listen as though they wished they had to listen. And Lord, we know that the message of God is thy message, and the message of God shall never, never come back void. I pray you'll speak to every heart and every soul, and we'll praise you for what you do, because we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Beloved, I want to speak to you concerning God's message. Anytime you have a message from God, it's always important. Now, if it's man's message, it's not important. But when God begins to speak, it's always an important message. And somebody said, well, what about this weather business? Brother Mays, you're talking about the weather. First of all, let me say this. God has a purpose and a plan for man. In that great purpose and plan, sometimes, my friend, Satan tries to turn it aside. And sometimes there's trouble and perplexity and sorrow. But as I read you in Genesis 3, a curse fell upon this earth. And the Bible said it fell fourfold. And then in the book of Luke, chapter 21, verse 25, it said, and there shall be signs in the moon, in the stars, and in the heavens. And somebody said, well, what's that got to do with this changing weather? Let me let you see something. The curse fell upon four things. It fell upon the serpent. Did you know the prettiest part of the snake is its belly? And when the serpent came in the Garden of Eden, he came upright, shining one. That's what the word serpent means. But because he beguiled the woman, God said, I'll put you on your belly, and all the days of your life shall you crawl on the ground and eat the dust of the ground. Did you ever see a serpent except on its belly? And do you know why that is so? Because the curse is upon the serpent. And then he said to the woman, he said, woman, because you listen to the voice of the devil, or the voice of the serpent, I'm going to put a twofold curse upon you. God said, first of all, when you bring a little baby into the world, there'll be sorrow. In other words, she'll go down to the valley of the shadow of death. And then he said, woman, the husband shall have rule over thee. Then he turned to the man, the third part of that curse, and he said to the man, because you have listened to thy wife, and because she yielded, he said, two things shall be yours as a curse. First of all, he said, by the sweat of your face. My granddaddy used to say the sweat of the brow, but that's not in the word of God. God said, the sweat of your entire face shall ye earn your bread. And when you see a man out here working, remember, and sweat coming down his cheeks, it's the part of the curse. And then he said, when you see that undertaker take that body and put it in a casket and start out chunning the graveyard, he said, man, from dust thou wert taken, and dust ye shall return. He said, that's the curse upon man. But he came to this fourth curse, and he said, the ground shall bring forth thorns and thistles. And beloved, it says in Romans chapter 8 that the whole creation or the whole earth is groaning to be delivered. One of these days the curse is going to be lifted. Praise God, you talk about a time. There'll be no thorns on the roses. There'll be no curse upon the cattle. There'll be no curse upon the earth. And the Bible said for 1,000 years there will be a millennial. Oh, you talk about a time. Somebody said, what will it be, preacher? The Bible said the lion shall lie down with the lamb. Why, if you meet me in 1,000 years reign, you know what I think I'm going to do? If I die before the rapture, and listen, after I'm raptured out of that grave and changed, and when I come back with the Lord, I'm going back to that hole, and I'm going to stand there and say, oh, ground, you couldn't hold this body down. Praise God. I'm going to look at that hole in the ground. Somebody said, preacher, that's silly. But I want to tell you something, mister. The curse fell upon this earth. But one of these days when the curse is lifted, the Bible said the trees will clap their hands and the rocks will open their mouths. Wouldn't you love to hear the rocks sing, all hail the power of Jesus' name? Let angels prostrate fall. That's going to be a hallelujah time. Joe said I couldn't sing this morning, but you wait till the curse has been lifted. Bless God, I'll be able to sing, and there will be a glorious time, because the Bible said if you get sick, you're in with that, all you got to do is reach out the wind and get you a leaf and bite it. And it's be for the healing of the nations. The Bible says that the knowledge of the earth shall cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. Now you say, why are you saying that? Because of the curse that fell upon the earth. The curse that fell on Adam's race. And you say, well, what's that got to do with the weather? On July the 20th, 1969, there was a man stepping out of a rocket. His name was Neil Armstrong. The curse of this world had never reached the moon, as far as I know. The curse of this world had never touched that moon. But did you know, my friend, Neil Armstrong, July the 20th, 1969, got out and said, it's a short step for man, but it's a long step. And he stepped upon the moon. He brought the curse of Adam's race to the moon. And ever since that time, for 4.5 years, we've seen all kinds of cold weather, then hot weather, and storms and cyclones and floods. And the Bible says the world will be in perplexities, and even the heavens shall be shaken. And you say, preacher, do you believe that's why that we're having all of these changing weather reports? I believe it's so. You think back 4 years ago and a half. Listen, this thing's been confused. The curse of sin has been taken to the moon, and now the moon is under the curse of sin. My friend, every time man ever tried to fool with anything God had, he messed it up. Every time man ever fool with it. Well, you take the reason you got to put all kind of chemicals in your water. Man polluted the water. You take every, even the air that you breathe. They're talking about pollution. Man polluted the air, the streams, everything. And now the moon has been touched by the foot of a mortal man. And the curse of mortal man has reached that moon. You say, preacher, that doesn't sound right. Well, think it through. God said, Adam, said the curse of the ground, thorns and thistles. And because of that, my friend, it says the whole world is groaning and travailing in pain, waiting to be delivered. But there will come deliverance. Did you know Jesus died for three things? Jesus died first for the soul. I'm glad he saved my soul. And thank God he redeemed my soul. He died secondly for my body. Now listen to me. My body's not redeemed. Romans 8 says, waiting for the redemption of the body. Some glorious daybreak, I'll have a new body. Thank God corruption shall put on incorruption, and mortal shall put on immortality, and will be changed in the moment. You wait till I get my new body. Bless God, you talk about a time I'm going to have it. But the Bible says that the Lord died for the earth, and he's going to have the curse lifted off of this earth. There'll come a time when it'll be lifted, but when in the days to come, you see all the confusion concerning climate and concerning weather and concerning the floods and the cyclones and the storms. You remember the curse. Now somebody said, preacher, what about a curse? Is it bad if you've got your pencils? I want you to jot down, if you will, quickly, about 7 things about a curse. And we'll conclude today by telling you about the moon and how it's going to turn to blood, and the curse of God that's going to rest on that moon that governs the tide, that governs the weather, and we're going to see what God says. But notice, my Bible said there's a curse that'll fall. That's why John, I like this, listen, John on the Isle of Patmos said, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. But the curse was upon the first heaven and the curse was upon the first earth. And that's why John said, I saw a new heaven and I saw a new earth. Bless God. A new heaven that's never been cursed. A new world or earth that's never been cursed. But take your pencils today. First of all, in the Bible, there's a curse upon a blood rejecter. Somebody said, I don't understand that. Yes, sir. God says, and God tells us about the first man in the Bible that rejected the blood. And I'm sorry for these people today that say you can get to heaven without the blood and say that you don't need to preach the blood. Listen, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. setting. I want to tell you there's one working power in the blood. If one drop of blood that came from Emmanuel's veins falls upon your soul, thank God it can cleanse you from your soul, your sin. Isn't it blessed to realize that? And yet we've got these blood rejectors and blood deniers. Listen what the book says in the fourth chapter of the book of Genesis in verse 11. And God said, Cain, cursed be the ground for thy means, for thy sake, because the blood of thy brother's voice crieth from the ground. He said, there's a curse. The ground is cursed. And God said, because of that curse, I'll mark you. And God marked him so that he wouldn't kill him. And Cain had the mark of the curse of God on him because he rejected the blood. Let me show you the picture. The Bible said there are two brothers, Cain and Abel. Abel went down and started singing, there's a fountain. Of course, they didn't have that in that day, but he believed in the blood. And little Abel went down, got him a lamb, brought that lamb up and cut that lamb's throat. And the blood gushed out on the altar. And God looked down and had respect for Abel's offering. Here comes old Cain. He's a modern-day church member. He brings something good. He brings something clean. The first fruit of the ground. He believes in these dignified services. He believes in these formalistic services. He don't believe in the blood or the hallelujah. He wants this starchy kind. Now, sister, if you want it, you can have it. But I like the hallelujah kind myself. Bless God, I like the kind you can enjoy and the kind that you can have peace and joy in. Why, some of these churches you go in, only thing you feel is the bench you're sitting on. Say amen. Why, you know I'm telling the truth, and you sit there, bless God, and somebody gets up and squeals in the choir, beautiful aisle somewhere, and you don't know where it is, and she don't either, and bless God, you leave and go out and wonder, what in the world has happened? And you let a person get up and start singing, oh, there's power in the blood, oh, the blood shall never lose its power, and then you let that preacher get up and begin to preach about the blood and its power. I want to tell you, you'll see the saints as they begin to wipe away tears. They know the power of the blood. It does two things. First, we have forgiveness of our sins through the blood, thank God. And we have redemption through the blood. My friend, I'm glad for that today. Somebody said, but preacher, you put too much emphasis on it. No, I don't. I want you to know there's much in the Bible about blood. It starts in the book of Genesis, chapter 3 and verse 15. And somebody said it runs as a cord all the way through to the last chapter and the last verse of the book of the Revelation. And if you were to cut that cord, blood had run out of it, because there's a crimson tide, a blood stream through the Bible. And I'm glad that I'm one preacher that believes in preaching the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me show you just in the book of Leviticus. Would you let me show you? Notice verse chapter 8, it says, and Aaron came up wanting to be a priest. Moses said, all right, son, you got to have some blood on you. And so my Bible said that Moses took the right lobe of Aaron's ear and put blood on it. And then he took his right thumb and put blood on it. And then he said, take off your right sandal and stick out your right big toe. And he put blood on it. You say, why, preacher? Watch this. God said, if you listen, you have to have blood on your ear that you can listen like you ought to listen. You're going to hear the voice of God, mister. It takes a sanctified ear to hear. Woo, that makes me feel pretty good. Brother, he put blood on his ear. And secondly, he put blood on his right thumb. Now watch this. Every time Moses said, Aaron, when you pick up something, you've got to have pure hands under the blood. Praise God. And he said, son, I'm going to put blood on your right big toe so that you can walk and stay in step with God. Did you know what's the matter? Most folks in Alabama and Georgia and Tennessee and thus and so, you're trying to get ahead of God. And brother, you're not walking in step with the Lord. Get the blood on your toe, bless God, and you can stay in step with God. And he put the blood. Now, that's the 8th chapter. Notice the 14th chapter of Leviticus. I'm just going to show you. Now, notice what the Bible said. They brought a leper out there, and he cried, unclean! Notice what the book said. And the priest went in, his water, run over a basin, and he took two little birds. And you know what he did? He took one of those birds and cut his little throat and squeezed the blood out in a basin. And when he got through, he reached over and took the live bird, wrapped that little live bird down in that blood of the dead bird, and then took that blood that was on that bird, and that little bird shaking his wings, took him outside and lifted him up and let him fly away. Somebody said, what's that typical of? Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Rising, he justified. Really, forever, thank God. And I'm glad you sent me back into heaven. I'm glad for the blood, aren't you? Now, notice this. Let's read on in the 16th chapter. My, what a great book this is. Bible said once a year on the Day of Atonement, the high priest went in and he sprinkled blood 7 times. You know why? Not 6 times. That's man's number. Not 5 times. That's the number of grace. But 7 is the number of perfection. And he went in and sprinkled 7 drops of blood on the Holy of Holies. And then 7 drops of blood where he's going to stand so that he could stand for the nation Israel. And you say, that's good. It sure is. But I got something better. All he was standing for, the sin of Israel. One day John the Baptist was down yonder by the river bank. Praise the Lord. And he looked across that river and he saw a lamb. And he held up his hand. He said, not the lamb for a boy, not the lamb for a family, not the lamb, bless God, for a nation, but behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Praise the Lord. And when Jesus shed his blood on Calvary, no more goats to be offered, no more Amen. Turtle doves, Amen. No more sacrifices, for he entered in once. Praise the Lord. And shed his blood for the sins of the whole world. My Bible says Cain was cursed from the ground because he denied the blood. Let's come to the second curse in the Bible. Because the blood, notice, Bible said a man that covers his sin will be cursed. Joshua chapter 7, and notice verse 13 tells me that this thing is called cursed. Now you read it when you get home. Listen, and God said to this man, he said, hey, listen, Joshua, what's that over there? In Achan's tent. And he said, it's a cursed thing. You remember what Achan did? God told him to destroy everything. And he saved the golden wedge. And he saved the Babylonian garment. He said, why, that looks good. God said, destroy it. But you know what he did? He took that wedge and scratched a hole in his tent and said, my preacher won't know I got it. And he said, my wife won't know I'm sinning. And he said, bless God, I'll hide and cover up my sin. God says, cursed is that sin that's covered up in the camp. God put a curse on hidden sin. You may think, my friend, you can cover up your sin, but God put a curse on it, and you can't do it. Let me show you something. 3 men in the Bible tried to hide their sin whose name started with A. Follow me. Adam tried to cover up his sin, but in the cool of the day, God came down and said, Adam, where art thou? And he said, why, we were afraid, and we hid ourselves. And brother, he tried to hide his sin. Secondly, Achan tried to hide his sin, and God said, that thing's a curse. And you'll lose the battle. You know why many churches not having revival? They got so much covered sin that's brought a curse in the house of God. God said that thing's cursed. But there's another fella whose name was Ahab. You see, all of these fellas' names started with A. And you know what Ahab did? He covered up his sin. Old Jezebel. She told him, said, honey, you don't have to worry. And brother, somebody said, what about Jezebel? Did you know that my Bible said that Elijah ran 100 miles from her? Oh, you say, I didn't know that. Why, you say, Brother Mays, one old lady told me, she said, preacher, it's an impossibility for a man to run 100 miles. I said, not if Jezebel's after you, it's not. Amen. Bless God, I want to tell you something. And he ran 100 miles. Well, notice something. Old Ahab, his wife caused him to sin, and he covered up his sin. He went out and got some grapes the next day in Naboth's vineyard. He said, boy, this show is good. I tell you, I stole his vineyard. Nobody don't know. And Elijah shook a bush. And he heard that bush rattling. And it scared him. And he said, hast thou found me? Oh, the curse of hidden sin. God says, what does he say? He said, if you deny the blood, there's a curse on you. He said, if you cover up your sin, it'll be a cursed thing. Now, number 3. God says that there'll be a curse on the parent that does not restrain his child. And we're living in a modern day that said, don't whip your child. Just let your child have its way. And brother, you're seeing the results of a child having his way. Why, he does anything he pleases, comes in when he gets ready, tells mama, you're the old woman, says to the dad, you're the old man, and y'all are out of date. But oh, listen, that's brought a curse upon our nation. Listen, over in 1 Samuel 3, verse 13, my Bible tells a story. It said there's a man named Eli. And he had 2 sons, Hophni and Phinehas. Now watch this. Hophni and Phinehas sinned right out in front of the church door. And the daddy didn't do nothing about it. And the Bible said God put a curse on his house forever because he did not restrain his children in their sin. Listen, other words, he compromised with his children. He said, I'll not quit my children. Isn't that pitiful? Used to be a little tree behind the house up there where I live. It never had a chance. I want to tell you, bless God, my daddy used to keep them big juicy switches down there. And brother, you talk about whipping. You know, he had them kind of hickories that wrap around. And boy, that hum, home sweet home. When he'd start whipping, I mean, brother, he knew how. And when he wasn't even whipping, you know what he'd do? He'd get two big juicy switches just in case. And he'd put them behind. And some of you've got this in your house now. My mother used to have a picture of an old Indian riding a horse. And he was at sundown. And the thing was called at the end of the trail. How many of you remember an old picture like that? Some of you remember, I know. Yes, sir, several folks here. You remembering? Well, my mother had one of those, and my daddy kept him two good juicy switches always right behind that picture frame. And he'd go by once in a while, check them, see if there's brittle. If there's brittle, he said, but they won't do no good. He'd get them kind of wrap around your legs and cut and burn for three or four days and make you stand up in the corner instead of sitting down. He had them kind that really did the job. And I remember one time, I was outside, did something wrong. They said, you go in the house, I'm going to whip you. Now, I went in the house, and I wouldn't even say, but you talk about putting up a prayer. Boy, I sounded like Elijah and Abraham getting there. I said, now, Lord, he'll kill me, sure as the world. And I went under that frame, and I'd never noticed this. I saw them two big juicy switches coming out behind that frame, and I'd never noticed at the bottom of that frame. Do you know what it says on the bottom of that frame? I looked at those two juicy hickories, and then I looked at that frame, and I looked at those two hickories. You know what it says? I need thee every hour. And I said, Lord, no. No, you don't need them every hour, bless God. But I want to tell you something. My Bible said if you fail to restrain your children, the curse of God was upon Eli because he failed to restrain his children. My friend, you wouldn't want a curse to fall upon you, would you? Just because you refuse, listen, to restrain your children. It's a pitiful, sad thing when children can do as they please, act as they please. And you know, I was preaching one night, and a lady said to one lady, I'm not going back and hear Mace Jackson preaching more. He said that the baby starts speaking lies as soon as they're born. Said, how can a baby tell a lie when he can't speak? And so she came the next night and said, Brother Mace, the lady's awfully disturbed. How can a baby talk and tell a lie when he can't even talk? And I said, well, the Bible said when he's born, he goes away speaking lies. And I said, me and my wife had three boys, and they all told lies as soon as they're born. And she said, how? Well, I said, they'd be in the crib, just the little babies, couldn't talk a word. And they'd go, wah! And he'd go to crying, and you'd say, oh, the stomach's hurting. Oh, his head's hurting. And you'd reach down, pick him up, and he'd go, mm-hmm. You know what he's doing? He's hypocriting. That's what he's doing. Brother, listen, he's telling you a big old not-so-sir. And we got people all over this country, brother. And let me tell you something. Those little old babies can tell of them good ones. And boy, he'd cry, and there wouldn't be a thing wrong with him. You know what he's doing? He wanted us to pick him up. He told us a lie. There wasn't anything wrong with him. He is just spoiled. Did you know that? That's all that was wrong with him. We run everything today but with switches. We run a switch to cut the stove on. We run rerun the air conditioning with a switch. We run the vacuum cleaner with a switch. We run everything but our children with a switch. Say amen. And brother, we don't have many switches when it comes to our children. But the Bible said, Eli, because you restrain not your children, I'll put a curse on you. Now watch it. Let's come to the next one. There's a curse on people that rob God. Amen. Boy, that'll get folks. When you shoot at their pocketbook, that'll get them. I want to tell you, Malachi said, will a man rob God? And they said, wherein have we robbed thee, Lord? And he said, in tithes and offerings. Have you robbed me? And he said, I'll shut up the kingdom, or the doors of heaven, the windows of heaven. I'll shut those windows up and withhold the rain and the blessing until you pay up your tithes. My friend, let me tell you something. God's going to get him one way or the other. He may have to take you up to the hospital. Amen. I used to have a fellow in my church named Dowie. I had to go up there one time and had an operation for appendicitis. I was walking down the hall, and one of the men said, what's Brother Dower having taken out? I said, his tithes, friend. He's got, amen. That's what God is doing, taking his tithes out. He wouldn't pay them, bring them to church, and bless God, God has taken them out. And just as sure as your name's what it is, God said, if you rob me, I'll close the windows of heaven and will not bless you. And it's a sad thing the way people steal from God. I used to go to a place called Maryville, Tennessee. I'm not tell you the name because we have listeners that will order this record from there. And I'll not tell you the name of the church, but there's a man that came. And the church there that will get this record knows what I'm talking about. And he'd come, and I never did know whether he's really saved. I thought he was, but he's an usher. And then after every year I'd come, he'd sit over there and usher. And then I remember I came back to that church at Maryville, Tennessee, and he was gone. And I said to the preacher, I said, Pastor, where is Mr.? He said, shh. I'll tell you after the service. And so after the service, he said, I didn't want you to say it out loud. Said about 6 months ago, Brother Mays, one of the ushers came to me and said, Mr. So-and-so is taking money out of the collection when we count it. And the pastor said, wait a minute. Are you sure? Don't you accuse that man of stealing money when you count? And he said, yes, I saw him. And so the pastor said, well, don't say anything. Give him another chance. Maybe he won't do it again. And so 2-3 Sundays later, he's back there counting the money in this church in Maryville, Tennessee. And as he's counting the money, he slipped some money and put it in his pocket. And finally, they had to bring him from the pastor and the deacons. And the pastor got up and said, sir, I know you've been without a job. But why did you take it out of the collection plate? Why did you steal it from God? He got up and said, preacher, I'm leaving. And as far as I know, he left that day. But listen to what he said. He said, preacher, I've been taking up the offering here for 9 years in this church. And he said, what's the difference? Me taking it out of the plate and stealing it and half of your members stealing it and never putting it into the plate. He said, if you'll tell me the difference. He said, you've got deacons that don't tithe. He said, you've got Sunday school teachers that do not tithe. He said, preacher, I'm going to be honest with you and put me in jail if you want to. I took money out of the plate. I know members that stole from God that never did put it in the plate. I want to tell you that's a sad thing. Somebody said, preacher, now you weigh that and think about it. God says there's a curse. He said, I'll curse thee with a curse. I'd rather have 9 cents in my pocket with the blessing on him than to have 10 cents and the curse of God on it. Oh, the Bible said if you rob me of tithes and offerings, I'll be a curse that'll fall on you. Isn't that sad to think about a curse that would fall upon people because they robbed God? Now that's what the book says. Wherein have you robbed me with tithes and offerings? One thing that caused Judas was downfall. He loved the bag. And he sold his Lord for 30 pieces of silver and 30 shekels of shame. But I want to tell you what a sad picture that is. The curse of God falls upon the God robber. Now, let's come on. The curse of God falls upon the preacher that preaches not the gospel of the grace of God. Amen. Somebody said, I don't understand that preacher. Follow me. Listen to what the book says. In Galatians 1:8, it said, though an angel comes down from heaven and preaches another gospel, let him be accursed. Amen. He said, brother, in the next verse, verse 9, and if a man preaches any other gospel than the gospel of the grace of God, let him be accursed. I have only one gospel to preach, and that's the gospel that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. And on the third day, God raised him from the dead according to the Scriptures. But my Bible said, if a beautiful angel comes down here in Anniston, Alabama, and stands here in Saxon Baptist pulpit, and an angel preaches any other gospel, said it's not another gospel. Oh, but you pervert the gospel of the grace of God. And brother, there are a lot of people today, a lot of so-called preachers that are perverting the gospel of the Son of God. It's not what you eat or what you don't eat, whether you eat on Saturday. It's not baptism of waters plus grace. It's not holding out. Brother, it's the blood and nothing in my brain. Save it to the cross, I cling. And that's the gospel of the good news that Christ paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but his blood washed me white as snow. My friend, I'm trusting in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation. It's a blood salvation. It's salvation of the Lord. It's being born the second time. There are a lot of churches in Alabama that hasn't heard about the new birth in 20 years. They haven't heard about being born again. They haven't heard about being saved. They haven't heard about being cleansed in the blood. Their preacher doesn't know anything about it because he's not saved. Hasn't been born the second time. And God said, I'll put a curse on him. Oh, isn't it awful? You think about the preacher's going to wake up in hell and have members screaming and saying, you didn't preach the gospel to us. And you let us, the blind leads the blind. The Bible said they'll fall in the ditch. That's what the book says. Let me show you something here today quickly. Now watch this. Watch this. He said, and though a man preach any other gospel, let him be accursed. You know what that is? Let him be taken with the hand of God and grind him into the ground. Oh, let God's hand grind him into the ground. That's going to be an awful thing when these preachers that haven't preached. Now listen to me. Thank God God's got some real preachers in Alabama. I'm glad God's got some real preachers in Anniston. I'm glad God's got some old-fashioned preachers in Gadsden. Hallelujah. And God's got some old-fashioned preachers in Georgia. Thank God for it. But God, listen, says there are others, though, that are wolves in sheep's clothing. And they come preaching something that's not the grace of God. And they'll lead men to their own destruction. Oh, what a sad thing it is. Now watch it. Now I want to show you something. I was reading a book one time. It scared me. Said a preacher in England came down one morning and he said to the little girl that brings tea, he said, bring tea, please. And she brought tea. And he started to weep. And this rector, you know what, all I have to say, he was a rector of a church. And he started to weep. And the little girl said, wait a minute, I'll call your wife and two daughters. And his wife and two daughters came in and sat down. And his wife said, what's wrong? He said, honey, I've been trying to preach for 38 years. Oh, he said, I've been trying to get up in front of the congregation here in this little city outside of London and other places around London. And he said, I had a dream just a while ago. He said, I dreamed I died. And I screamed as I went into the very pits of the damned. Said, I cried as I went into the lake of fire. And said, I screamed. And she said, honey, but that was a dream. He said, that's not what was bad about it. He said, it wouldn't be so bad if I was going to hell. Because I didn't preach the gospel. But said, I saw the little girl that brings me tea and pours my tea here for me to drink. I saw her go to hell. And I heard her screaming, you didn't tell him. You didn't tell me about Jesus. You didn't preach the gospel to me. He said, I saw her fall into hell. His wife said, that's bad. But he said, that's not all of it. Honey, I saw my first daughter fall into hell in that dream. And she's screaming and crying, Daddy, you didn't preach the truth to me. And she said, now, honey, that's a dream. He said, wait a minute, I'm not through. I saw my other daughter fall into hell. And that's not all. He said, I saw you fall in hell. And I heard you screaming. I was a preacher's wife. And you didn't tell me that Jesus died for my soul of sin. And he said, you know, I woke up and my pillow was wet. And perspiration had drenched my pillow. And I recognized, he said, the curse of God was on me. Because he said, it says in the book of Galatians chapter 1, though an angel come down from heaven and preach any other gospel, let him be accursed. And they say within 20 minutes, as he was sipping on his tea, he was in such a strain that he had a heart attack and died. And they said people came for miles. And his wife would walk around the casket over there at the funeral home and say, my God, did he really go to hell? Did he really go to hell? My Bible said if a preacher or a man preach any other gospel than the gospel of the grace of God, let him be accursed. What a sad thing that is. Now, listen to me. Bible speaks about the curse that's going to fall upon a man that dies in his sin. Matthew, the Bible says in Matthew, I want to show you, Matthew chapter 25 and verse 41 says, then shall I say unto you, depart from me, ye cursed. God said, I'm going to say that you're cursed with an everlasting curse. And they'll be cast into outer darkness, and there'll be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Now you see, what is that curse? All right, let's see. That besetting sin was cursing. You know what the curse in hell will be to that man that blasphemed and cursed every breath? Oh! He'll still be cursing 10 billion years from now down there in the regions of the damned. That curse will fall on it. Here's a man that's filled with a lust demon, and it runs in his vein, and he's broken up homes. And he dies without Jesus and goes to hell. You know what his curse will be in hell? He'll still desire that lust. And brother, that lust drove him mad and sent him to hell will be the curse that'll plague him through the endless ages of eternity. Now, I'm a Baptist preacher that believes that there's a literal, consuming, everlasting, amen, blistering fire in hell. But I want to tell you, that's not going to be all the suffering in hell. Not all the suffering will be fire in hell. That man that's had the booze bottle and drank himself to death and went to a drunkard's grave and a drunkard's hell. When he gets to hell, that curse of that drunkenness will run right in his body and run all over him. He'll desire booze a billion. from now in hell. That's what Jesus said when he said, these shall depart from me. And I'll say, ye cursed, depart from me. Oh, into the place prepared for the devil and his angels. My Bible said in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 13, Christ was made a curse for us. Oh, the Bible said that the world, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. He said, cursed is he that hang up on that tree. Now you watch this, and I'm going to help you today. Listen to me. That curse was placed on the Son of God. And the curse of the law was nailed there when Jesus died for you and me. I remember one night I got through preaching, a little cute girl about 4 years old came down. I didn't think she'd gotten any kind of the message I'd preached. She walked down, tears in her eyes. And I said, young lady, are you a Christian? That little 4 year old girl looked up and said, praise the Lord. She said, he took my curse and I'm blessed of the Lord. I said, honey, you got it right. You may not be but 4 years old, but that's the gospel, that Christ was nailed to the cross, being made a curse for us. Listen to me. It's blessed, but you think about dying and going to hell, having that curse to run through your body. Now let me give you something, and then I'm going to close in just a few moments. Bible says that the ground was cursed, and by one man sin entered. And because of that sin, the curse came upon the whole world. Now watch it. In the 11th chapter of the book of Genesis, man said, we're going up there at that moon. And we're going up to heaven. And they built a tower. Now watch this. And God let them start it. I don't know how far they got. They might have got away out yonder. I don't know how far they got, but they got away out yonder. And God said, I'm not ready for this whole heavens to be cursed now. And so God came down and twisted their tongues. Now watch this. And scattered them. Now the school system in America says put them all together, but God's word said scatter them and keep them apart. Say amen right there. Brother, these left wingers and all of these politicians that won't vote, so say, put them all together and bus them 40 miles in the dark so that they'll get to go to school together. That's not what the book says. When they said we don't want to be separated, lest we be scattered, God came down and scattered them and twisted their tongues. And the word of God says that they were scattered. But brother, that's God's plan. God set the bounds of their habitation. Amen. And God put them where he wanted them. And man, in the sin and the curse of sin, tried to move them. And man's done a pretty good job. And this thing's going to get worse and worse till the coming of the Son of Man. Go back yonder and watch this tower. And they said, we're going out yonder. And God said, oh no, boys. Not yet. And God came down and twisted their tongues and scattered them. But they got so wise in these last days, until he put Neil Armstrong in there, 16th day of July. He shot him out in 1969. And on the 20th day of July, 1969, you probably got the book or the newspaper clipping. You saw his foot. And when his foot touched that moon, by one man sin entered the world. And the curse came because of that man's sin. And now the moon is under the curse. And one day, that old moon's going to start dripping with blood. God said, and the sun will turn black as sackcloth of hair, and the stars will fall out of their sockets, and the moon will turn as it were blood and drip. Listen to me. You're going to see all kinds of turbulent weather. You're going to see all kinds of storms and tornadoes. Oh, you're going to see it get cold one day and hot the next day, because the curse of sin is upon the moon that governs the tide, and the tide governs the a lot of our weather conditions. Say, what's going to happen, brother? Listen, until that glorious day when Christ comes and the curse is lifted, it'll get worse and worse until Jesus comes. But watch this. Here's the pitiful part of it. Some people will have an eternal curse on them, and they'll be cast in outer darkness, and there will be a curse forever. Years ago over here in West Georgia, listen to me, I went to a preacher's meeting. Or his church and held a meeting. I didn't know why the people didn't like me. And about Friday night, I said to him, I said, preacher, what's wrong with this crowd? I said, they don't laugh at anything I say, and they don't cry when I cry. And I said, they sit there like they think they're little wooden Indians, and bless God, I'm a chief or something, and they don't do a thing while I'm a preaching. He said, they're streaked head baddies. I said, streaked head? I preach to every other kind. What's a streaked head? He said, they don't believe in missions, don't believe in paying the preacher. I said, Lord, I've been preaching to them all my life. Didn't know what to call them. Amen? Amen. And I never will forget. I didn't know what to call them streaking heads. I didn't know what. I'm a missionary. Independent, if you please.
Go ahead, preacher.
Baptist preacher. I'm not ashamed of it, but I want to show you something. I never heard of a streaking head. Now, and so on Friday night, he said, Brother Mays, he said, I used to hear you years ago when I was having an awful battle in this town. Said, can you come eat supper with me tomorrow night? I said, sure. And I went over to West Georgia there the next night, came to his old daddy's place where he lived. His daddy had lived there. And his wife said, supper! He said, before we go to supper, I want Brother Mays to come with me. And we went down, he said, Brother Mays, when I was 14 years old, my daddy was on the curse of booze. Now you watch this. Listen to me. You know why the Kennedys are under curse? Old Joe Kennedy brought that all that Scotch whiskey over here, and brother, that family's under the curse of God. But here's a man over here in West Georgia said to me, preacher, my daddy used to carry a jug around his arm. Drink all the time! And said, when I was 14, one day he came out on the porch and said, come here, son. He said, I've lost every battle I ever fought with this thing. And said, I'm going to take my shotgun. Said, you see those little trees down there? I'm going down out of those trees, and I'm going to drink all this jug of liquor. And I'm going to wrestle with the devil. If I don't win out this time, I'm going to blow my head off. And he said, Brother Mays, I went back in the house. Me and my mama was in this house. And 48 minutes or 50 minutes after my daddy went down over that jug of whiskey, we heard that shotgun say, pew! And said, we ran down there and said, Brother Mays, I saw Dad's head half shot off. And I reached down and picked him up. And he said, son, I've lived under the curse of God, and I'm dying that way. He said, you tell people I rooted this ground up like a hog would, rooting up the... And he said, Brother Mace, actually, my daddy had rooted up all under those little trees. And he said, son, I lost the battle. And he said, I want you to tell them that I lost the battle. He said, 3 days later, I stood in the hospital. My daddy died, and I reached down and picked him up in my arms. And he said, son, don't go this way. Because this is the way of the curse of God. Don't go this way! He said, son, don't die like Papa's dying. He said, Brother Mace, my daddy died in my arms 3 days later with the curse of God on him. And he said, I made my way after the funeral to a little church and I trusted Jesus Christ. And said, when I was 15, God called me to preach. And he said, this town's looked down on me because my daddy was a drunkard. My daddy committed suicide. And my daddy died under the curse of God. And he said, I want you before supper to come down on these big trees now. There's where my daddy died under the curse of God. He said, I want you to lay your hands on me, Brother Mays, and pray that I'll be able to keep people from going to a drunkard's grave. That I'll be able to keep people from dying under the curse of God. And I went down there, my friend, and he knelt down. I laid my hands on that little old preacher. We got up, started toward the house, and he said, they won't give you much here, Mays. They don't believe in giving a preacher anything. He said, but I've been saving some money, and I want to tell you how much I love you for coming to help me. He said, here's $100 bill. This will help you some. My church won't give you much. I said, listen, put it back in your pocket. I said, I'm glad I could come. He said, preacher, you don't know what a scourge I've had to preach under and how people look down on me because my daddy drank and my daddy committed suicide and my daddy died under the curse of God. Oh, you say, Brother Mays, listen to me. When man went to the moon, the curse of God fell on the moon. That's bad. But on this Sunday afternoon, did you know the curse of God's on you? If you're not a Christian, or if you're running from God, or if you're hiding sin, the curse, that thing's a cursed thing. Oh, you say, what can I do? He that knew no sin was made sin for us. And the Bible said, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. I'm glad he took my curse. I'm glad he died for me on Calvary. Bless his name. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Thank you for listening.